Salam, I am KAHANTAZADAQ. The information I'm about to provide you with this right knowledge is not to encourage anyone to get involved in illegal gun sales or production, nor is it to encourage anyone, any tax obligor, to avoid paying taxes. This is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent counsel, and then please be advised. What I'm about to give you is strictly for educational, informational, entertainment purposes only. Question that I have here is, are you obligated to pay taxes? I want to go over two federal rules, two special federal rules, statutes that you've never heard about that covers guns and taxes. First of all, I'd like to turn your attention to Staples versus the United States. It is known even by elementary school students. Ignorance of the law is no excuse. But what if a man wasn't aware of the complicated crimes and statutes, such as these hundreds and hundreds of statutes that's actually in the IRS codes, the Federal Internal Revenue Codes? Well, the Supreme Court have actually implicated two very important rules, federal rules that is, that are much more lenient towards federal crimes than any state ever would be. The first federal rule is a defendant must know the facts that make the crime illegal. I reiterate, a defendant must know the facts that make the crime illegal. So the mens rea requirement is premised upon the idea that one must possess a guilty state of mind and be aware of his or her misconduct. However, a defendant need not know that their conduct is illegal to be guilty of a crime. In Staples versus the United States, Staples claimed that he didn't know that the weapon that he purchased was actually previously converted into an automatic machine gun by a third party. The Supreme Court ruled in his favor. Well, the court ruled that he couldn't be convicted because he didn't know the weapon had actually been modified. If he didn't know the gun had been modified, he couldn't be convicted of the crime. The second rule, special federal rule, arose in a 1991 case, Cheek versus the United States. John Cheek was an airline pilot who actually went to various seminars of tax protesters. At these seminars, he met lawyers that told him that he didn't have to pay federal taxes on his wages, and the other attendees that they didn't have to pay federal taxes on their wages, because federal taxes on their wages are paid in equal exchange for labor and therefore don't qualify as income. Cheek stopped paying federal income taxes and was convicted of willful failure to pay. But Cheek appealed to the Supreme Court, which ruled in his favor. According to the court, failure to pay federal income taxes couldn't be described as willful if the defendant honestly believes that he is not legally required to pay income taxes. I reiterate, the court ruled that if the defendant honestly believed that he's not legally required to pay the taxes, he can't be guilty. It doesn't matter how absurd and how stupid the belief is, that only if the defendant holds that belief sincerely. Despite the fact that Cheek had previously attended court trials where he watched some of his tax protesters go to jail. It didn't change the court's view. The court ruled later in a similar view in 1994 where Ratzlaff versus the United States. Baltimore Ratzlaff went to Las Vegas and he won a lot of money. Under federal law, he was required to report any bank deposits more than $10,000. The casino suggested that Ratzlaff take his winnings in smaller portions and he deposit them separately so as to avoid the federal reporting requirement. And that's what Ratzlaff did. When Ratzlaff didn't know it was a federal crime to willfully evade the federal reporting requirement, Ratzlaff didn't know. Ratzlaff was convicted, but the Supreme Court reversed his conviction. The court cited the earlier cheat case, which I mentioned earlier, and held that Ratzlaff couldn't be found guilty unless he knew about reporting requirement and that the criminal law that prohibited evasion of the reporting requirement. Congress later amended the statute. Ratzlaff was set at liberty. So the question is, do you have to pay federal income taxes? Are you an obligee? If you're a U.S. citizen, you're required to pay federal income taxes. Mr. John H. and others, be certain to leave your comment below. This is not a debate forum. We'll deal with facts and truth. No theory, Mr. J.D., Mr. Nicholas Kerfoot. Just facts over fiction. Those of you that engage in your theoretical nonsense, keep it off of this channel. If you found this video helpful, information that you actually ascertain something useful from, leave a donation. Donate for whatever you think the video's worth. You can donate on Cash App, cash.me/tazadaqshah. Donate on PayPal, paypal.me/tazadaq. Or you could donate on Zelle. The email address is tazadoctrine@gmail.com, tazadoctrine@gmail.com. Thank you. Be sure to like, share, subscribe, and leave a comment below, Mr. John H. Thank you, John. Thanks, folks. Make it a great day. This is Right Knowledge for Real, and the truth will make you mad. Remember to scan the barcode. The barcode will take you directly to the website to order books and to become a secured creditor and order other products. Thank you. To those of you that's unaware of the Ratzlaff case, Waldemar Ratzlaff, the defendant, accumulated 160,000 debt at the High Sharia Casino in Nevada. When the time came to settle this debt, Ratzlaff was informed by the casino personnel about the legal necessity to report cash transactions exceeding $10,000 to state and federal authorities. Understanding that this requirement also applied to banks, Ratzlaff deliberately acquired multiple cashier's checks, each under $10,000, from different banks to pay off his debt without triggering any reports. This act is structuring Len to Ratzlaff criminal charges. He was accused of intentionally splitting a large cash transaction into smaller ones to evade the bank's obligation to report large cash dealings, a violation of federal law. Despite his knowledge of the bank's reporting duty, Ratzlaff asserted that he was unaware that his actions were illegal. check the case out for yourself. What was the issue here? The issue was whether, for conviction under the anti-structuring law, the government must prove that the defendant acted with the knowledge that his conduct was lawful. What's the rule of law? To convict the defendant for willfully violating an anti-structuring law, the government must prove that the defendant knew his conduct was unlawful. So it takes us to the reasoning analysis. The Supreme Court observed that willfulness in this context required more than just an intentional invasion of reporting a requirement. It also required knowledge of the illegality of the conduct. The court emphasized that willful is a term that demands context-specific interpretations. The court found that applying a uniform meaning of willfulness across various statutes is consistent with legislative intent and judicial precedent. Furthermore, the court reasoned the structure is not inherently illegal and that there could actually be legitimate reasons for an individual to structure transactions. Therefore, knowledge of illegality is necessary component to differentiate between innocent structuring and criminal conduct. The conclusion? The conviction was reversed because the jury was not instructed that they needed to find Ratchraff knew that structuring transactions to evade reporting was illegal. Ratchraff won.